here we are, Wednesday night, HellaBass Live. What's going on, everybody? We're on a roll. We're not staying on our normal nights, Wednesday nights. It's going well. Excited to be here talking some fishing and talking some boats and batteries and I guess just getting charged up for the season. What's going on, RJ?
Hey, Rich. How's it going?
Good. So you're all traveling the south right now. Like,
yeah, hitting
where in the world is RJ right now? Tell the folks where you are.
Opelika or Opelika, depending on who you talk to. Opelika, Alabama. In a cockroach hotel. We didn't want to come to you live from the road, so we pulled into a hotel, and an $85 hotel in Alabama is a little bit different than an $85 hotel in Nebraska.
Do you wish you would have spent $90 now?
I don't even know if that would have done it.
Nice. Yeah, is it one of those that's looks good from afar, but far from good?
Yeah, the hotel lobby was very deceiving. We thought we scored a bargain and then got to our room, and that wasn't the case.
I like the classic curtains. It's a good look.
Yeah, they're nice.
Brian says the audio and video's good. Yeah. No, they're not even dated at all. Very trendy.
Mm-hmm. Definitely updated recently.
AJ's in the house. Fellow Nebraskan, AJ. He's here.
Yeah. That's the back of the boat hammer right there.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys talked about that the last time he was on, but I think he was leading the Nebraska State Tournament out of the back of the boat.
Mm-hmm.
It's not who you want to draw.
Pretty solid painter as well. If you're into rock crawlers, mm-hmm. He's your guy.
Yep, for sure.
Lots of familiar faces, lots of members. Good to see everybody. So tonight is all about batteries. We're going to do a deep dive on charging systems, batteries, trolling motors, graphs, power sources, what's good, what's bad, what the history, where we're going, all that stuff. And we're just, we've got a list of questions to go off of people that left them ahead of time, but obviously you want to get to a bunch of questions that people have live in chat. So get them ready for tonight. Brian, good reminder. Let's get our thumbs up out of the way now. It's a good idea. I like your thinking, Ryan. So I guess before we get too hot and heavy while people are rolling in, RJ, maybe just give us a little backstory on yourself and Powerhouse.
Right. So I was born and raised in Nebraska. Not the optimal place to be born at if you want to be in the fishing industry. But anyways, always had an interest in power storage and kind of looked into getting into this. And I had Bob Croxton as a mentor, and he was kind of helping me along getting started. And after a while, he had a lot of good ideas like the 16 volt and a few other things. He's the mad scientist behind it all. He pitched a bunch of good ideas at me, and I said, you know, why don't we do this together? So it's me and Bob, and Bob's actually right over here. He's passed out on the bed in the cockroach hotel.
Very cool. And so you guys are based out of Nebraska, right?
Nebraska and Atlanta. Our warehouse is in just right north of Atlanta. Yep. Based out of northeast Nebraska, technically, though. Correct.
So what made you guys decide to get into the power game in lithium and batteries and so forth?
Like I said, just a big interest in how everything works and doing a lot of research and then realizing all the cool things that you can do with it and things that people haven't probably otherwise thought of, and bringing those ideas to reality was really the whole purpose behind it.
Right on. So I'm seeing a few questions roll in here and I'm starring them. So be patient. We'll get into those. We just want to set the stage a little bit here. I guess obviously primarily you guys are in lithium and you feel that's where like the industry is going. Right. But I assume you know a fair amount about traditional battery and some of the comparisons and things like that. I guess from your perspective, what is the, like, obviously, I don't know, if you've been in fishing for a while, right? If you go back just even 10, 15 years ago, it was probably, I don't know, 90% lead acid. And then we kind of had
probably
maybe a decade
more than
of
that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then maybe a decade of where AGM, you know, Optima kind of came in at first, right. And they were kind of the leaders in AGM and the blue tops and all those. And then there's been a lot of AGM. And now in the last, let's call it five-ish. I mean, lithium's been around longer than that, but I would say they've really started to gain popularity and become a little more readily available in the last 5 years, give it or take. Like, what mm-hmm. what are the,
right.
I guess, the big differences? Obviously, there's a tons that you get into the technology, but like high level, what's the big differences between the old lead acid into AGM and then kind of lithium?
Right. So the biggest thing to me is the ability to store a lot more energy in the same amount of space. So we're able to utilize the spaces in the backs of our boats because they just keep getting more full, and being able to utilize that space is crucial. The other thing is weight. Weight's another big factor. You know, a lot of boats obviously pick up a little bit of performance, dropping a little bit of weight out of the back of the boat. But yeah, that's the two biggest things I would say.
Yeah. One small note, if you're fidgeting with that headphone case, it's probably making your audio come in and out.
That's probably, yeah. Was it opening? I think I was opening it. I'm sorry.
Yeah, probably not helping. cool. Yeah, so really the biggest advantages, right? Lithium, like you said, more compact, lighter weight. I guess a constant delivery, right? Of
yep.
I guess is voltage. Yep. Is that the correct term or
voltage drop? Yep.
So really the traditional methods of lead acid and AGM, you start at the very best of whatever 12 volt battery is what, 13.4 or something like that when it's fully charged? Or?
Yeah, but in reality you're probably looking at high 12s. Yep.
Right. But I mean like you get that AGM. For like a minute.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then it's
and then
a slow
take that surface charge off and it's yep. Correct.
Right. So like
right.
you get your best performance in the morning and then you get a slow degradation, whether it's your trolling motor, your graphs or anything else throughout the day.
Correct.
So really the only downside to lithium is maybe the initial price. The upfront investment is maybe a little higher, but like I think you could argue in some cases depends on the level of use and how long you're going to keep them, right, that the lifetime cost can be on par if not advantageous.
Right. And I think the best example of that is we offer a single 36 volt 60 amp hour battery. It's one battery, but that one battery is going to give you equal, if not maybe slightly better, maybe around 10% more runtime, more power than three lead acid batteries in series for your trolling motor. And we can do that with one battery. And that battery retails for $1,299.99. Now, you know, a decent AGM battery that you might expect to get 4 years out of, 3 years, maybe. They're going for what, $450, I think they are now. So you're actually more money into a set of AGMs than just buying one 36 volt lithium. Now with that, you know, obviously comes needing a new charger and other things like that. But in the long run, you're talking a set of three batteries. That's $1,300 AGM. It's going to last you 3 years, or a 10 to 15 year lithium battery. That's $1,300. So there are ways around that, you know, to spend the same amount and get more. But yeah, for the most part, the initial investment is going to be a little bit heavier than with a lead acid AGM setup.
Good analogy, Brendan. He said lead acid dies throughout the day, just like your spirit, if you're not catching them.
That's true. That's true.
A couple early questions in here. So Funky Fisherman said he's looking for a lithium upgrade. So this is the show for him. He said he's got cranking battery and he's looking at trolling motors. So we'll definitely dive into some of the options and probably expand upon what RJ talked about, you know, 12s versus 24s versus 36 and the advantages and disadvantages and some of that. One thing I know this comes up in Nebraska and Iowa and Minnesota and Wisconsin is, you know, what do you do in the winter? Do you just hook them up intermittently? Do you charge them? Do you not charge them? Do you store them charged? Do you store them partially charged? Should they come in? Like, what right. is the recommendation, I guess, like from your perspective? Or what do you tell your customers to do with their lithium batteries?
So if you're going to store them in a heated garage and you're not using them for 3 or 4 months out of the year, it's fine to leave them in the boat.
Looks like he stalled out there a little bit.
I got lost. Are you watching over there?
Did we lose you?
Now a little bit. Yeah, you're kind of back
I'm
now.
Here.
Okay. All right. So you were about to say like if it's heated. So I guess your definition of heated, does that mean like 70, 40? Like what's your definition?
Like
of
a temperature controlled garage, like 50 degrees. 50 degrees or warmer. That's going to be optimal. So yeah, if you're storing it in a heated garage, then you're going to want to keep it at 50% or above throughout the winter. And then if you're storing it outside or in a quonset or something that isn't heated, you're going to want to pull those batteries out and take them inside. And then the same thing, just keep them above 50%. It's not as much of a chore as it used to be with our lead-acid and batteries having to drag those inside. You know, obviously with lithium being quite a bit lighter, it's a lot easier on the back pulling them out every year than doing that with lead-acid.
Sure. And I guess that would be the advantage of a 24 or a 36 battery, right? Is like, if I've got to pull 3 12 volts, right? I got a bunch of wires and jumpers,
right?
And all those things dangling.
You can pull one battery, right?
Label them and like all that stuff, right? On a 36 or 24 volt system, depending on the size of your trolling motor, right? It's literally a couple cables and you're in
just
and out
connected so. from your main lead, right? Yep, in and out, right. So not a big deal. Yep.
So basically, if you're above freezing in your garage, if you're hanging in the 40 50s, leave them in the boat, turn your breaker switches off. Yep. On your boat, make sure they got some kind of charge on.
Yep.
Them and do they
correct
like, you know, in Minnesota, where we've got, I don't know, 3, 4, maybe 5 months solid of winter, like if you charge it end of October and you go out there,
yeah,
say April, what would you expect that battery to be at after sitting for 4 months?
So our batteries are programmed through the BMS to expel 1% of their overall energy monthly. So if you started off with 100% battery in October, you know, November, you're going to be looking at probably 90, 99% and so on and so forth. So by April, you're going to be above 90% yet.
Okay. So very little. It's just, yeah. The BMS itself.
Very little. Right, yeah.
Kind of like it's operating and checking the battery and doing its things. And it's going to just kind of just trickle off a little bit at that point.
Right.
What
yep.
about.
Yep. Just to keep everything awake.
What about the people that recommend to say like, leaving it plugged in, like if you've got a smart charger, whether it's like one of your chargers or a power pole charger, is that like good, yeah. not good? You not recommend that?
There's not really a real good purpose to put a lithium battery on a maintained charger. The best practice is to top that battery off and then unplug your charger because it's not gonna do anything. That lithium absorbs energy a lot better, and it's trickle charging does nothing, and most of the time if you have a quality battery, that BMS isn't going to accept the charge. It's already shut down. It's told the charger, hey, I'm done charging, and the charger will turn off.
Sure.
So no so real good reason to do that, to leave it plugged in.
Yeah, Yeah, I guess it's kind of, so it says, is it bad to keep a lithium battery 100% charged when stored? Like any electric vehicle, they don't recommend charge to 100%. But I guess what you're saying is the BMS will basically, or.
Yep, correct. Yep.
Nice. I guess touch on BMS. We're throwing out the acronym BMS, but maybe not everybody knows what a BMS is, RJ.
That's the battery management system. It's basically a computer chip inside that battery that controls all the parameters, all of your safety features, so on and so forth. It's the brains behind the battery.
Right. And that's kind of what maybe the difference is in definitely the newer leading brands like yourself in lithium is the BMS systems that make these more than, I guess that's another differentiator we didn't really talk about, right? Traditional lead-based batteries are, they don't have BMSs. They don't have smart systems. They're not, I mean, correct. This is a much more active piece of technology than a traditional battery. Maybe just go a little bit more on what that really means and what that does and how that's changed and what, you know, what special things can the BMS do for you?
So the main purpose is going to be for your safety features that are built into that BMS, like over voltage protection, under voltage protection, over temp protection, under temp protection. And what that's going to do is if that battery ever gets out of the parameters that it was designed to be ran through, if it ever gets outside of those parameters, the battery is going to, the terminals are essentially going to disconnect themselves from the battery pack, and cut power to it. So then you don't have voltage or thermal runaway or anything like that.
Right. So that basically is the safety fail. It's just like the, what do they call it? On your motor, right? On your outboards, the newer outboards, they'll go into guardian mode. They won't let you run out of oil. They won't let you
do correct.
Things that will cause it to cataclysmically fail or have any kind of safety issues, or just like your trucks and your newer vehicles have those types of features. So it's all related to that. And that's correct. Probably the biggest difference than maybe what you heard about batteries. You know, maybe the first lithiums that came out a decade ago probably didn't have either didn't have BMSs or not as robust of BMSs that modern lithiums have.
Right. Correct.
And then the BMSs also allow you to do apps and talk to your phones and do all kinds of fun stuff, right? Like, so I assume PowerHouse has some kind of app to like watch and maintain your batteries and.
Yep, the Bluetooth feature works in conjunction with the BMS, so you're able to go on the PowerHouse Lithium app and see everything from your overall pack voltage to the internal cell temperature of your pack, anything you could ever imagine wanting to see on your battery, you can see from that app. You can even go as far as dialing into each individual cell and seeing the voltage of each individual cell. We can calculate the cell differential based on that, which is how we diagnose over the phone. If a customer calls us and says, "Hey, I think something's not working right," we can dial into that battery remotely, have them send us a picture of their cells. From that, I can gather whether or not, hey, this is a battery issue, or hey, you want to look further up the line. This isn't a battery issue. Your battery is perfectly fine. You might want to check, you might want to check something further up the line.
Right. Wiring, fuses, grounds.
Right.
Myriad
so
of
we're
other
able
things.
To eliminate the battery. Whereas in the past, you have an issue like that and you don't really know where to go. Whereas now we can dial into that battery, see exactly what's going on. I can say, hey, yeah, that battery is working great. Or, hey, no, that battery isn't working. You were correct. Move up the line. So.
Right on.
It's a big time saver for sure.
Great. Yeah. So just to clarify, back to JJ's point, is there any harm or risk to leaving your lithiums hooked up to a charger?
No, as long as it's a lithium charger, as long as it's a charger that's designed to charge lithium, that charger should turn off. That charger should turn off as soon as it hits the target voltage and knows that it's fully charged. It should turn off and it should turn back on. So not really, but like I said, at that point, is there really a reason to leave it plugged in?
Right. Okay. Yep. Hopefully we got that. So let's see here. I want to recognize T1D Steve became a member tonight. Awesome. Much appreciated. Got to give him the old one of us. Welcome to the team, Hella. Let's see here. Lots of good questions coming in here. So Stephanie says, do all lithium batteries let you know they're going to die? Or do you have to... without spending more money to get the apps that show you everything. And I think that probably really depends on the manufacturer to manufacturer, with human, how they're set up, right?
You know, for the most part, a lithium isn't really going to give you any warning. If you don't have a Bluetooth monitoring system, I mean, you can watch the voltage and kind of have a pretty good idea of when it's going to die. But in terms of knowing when it's going to die, there's no real good pointer that you can look to say, oh yeah, that battery, you know, that battery is about ready to die, because they work at full capacity all the way until the end, and then they just fall off and they're done.
Right. Which is just like if you've got a Ryobi weed eater or a weed chopper or a Black and Decker drill, or right, all those lithiums, they go 100% until they don't go at
100% until they don't. Right. Yeah. Yep. But same thing with the lithium boat batteries.
But I assume your guys' app and all that is included. So if you buy a battery, the app, you just connect them. I mean, is there no extra cost to run the app? Is there?
Correct. Yep. And all of our batteries that are 40 amp hours and larger are compatible with the Powerhouse Lithium app, and the app is free. We even have a 12-volt 8-amp-hour Vexlar battery, which is the very first in the industry to have a Bluetooth module. So now you can monitor your Vexlar charge out on the water as well, which is real handy.
Nice. Brandon says he just got 2 12-volt Powerhouse Lithiums, and he wants to know.
Hey, thanks, Brandon.
Yeah, he's got a 2-bank NACO charger or NOCO. He says, do I just hook up each battery with each bank?
Yeah. So yep. Definitely, yep.
So it's just like if you had two.
Yeah, just like your lead acid base. Or AGM. Yep. Right. Yep. No different. Just make sure it's on the lithium setting is the only thing you'd change, really.
JJ says, thanks for the info. All right. Mainstream Fishing. He's one of us now. Welcome, Jermaine. Awesome. Got to give him his due. Appreciate it. Let's see. Yeah, I did say Black and Decker. We're talking about hedge trippers. Hedge trimmers, Brandon, you know that. So Chris says, do lithium batteries need to be placed in a storage mode when not used for a few weeks? Something about RC cars recommended that.
There's not really a storage mode. There's no way to set them in any kind of storage mode other than just unhook them, basically.
Mm-hmm. All right. Nick says he just got a new Minn Kota PC charger this winter in preparation of adding lithium as he goes. Is that pretty good charger, the Minn Kota PC?
Yeah, that'll compatible work. With lithiums? Yeah. Yeah. So I actually used a Minn Kota PC charger for quite a while. You're just going to want to make sure that you have that on the AGM setting. This is per Minn Kota. The AGM setting will charge a lithium battery on that charger. They've also got a Minn Kota PCL, which was specifically designed for the lithium batteries. But yeah, the PC will work, just not as well as the PCL.
Yeah, and the PCL just came out in the last year or so, I think.
Yeah, I think it's been about a year. Yeah,
and they've been Johnson. We all love Johnson Outdoors, but those have not exactly been readily available, from what I've heard. Much like the 360s.
No, they've all been hard to get.
Yeah.
And the Apex units, and yeah, I just about had to fight Bob for an Apex 13 the other day. I finally found. I've been looking for. We've had two of them on order for a few months now. And I finally found one down at Wetumpka Marine in Alabama. And I got it. And Bob said, you know what? You don't need that thing. You got ice up there for the next 4 months. And so I said, all right, I guess you can have this one and I'll find another one. And then I found out that apparently there nobody's getting one until like this fall. So I ended up with an Apex 16, which is going to make my boat slower than it already is. But that's all right. But yeah, about everything from them is impossible to get.
Chris, we're probably we'll save the fantasy talk for next time. We got a little window here before the next event, so we'll probably save fantasy talk for another stream. All right, a couple people trickling in. Right around 100 people tonight. That's cool. So Tad says, do you know how long a 36-volt, 50-amp lithium will last on a 112 Ultrex? Coming from a guy who fished on 80 plus most of the time, can I get a full day? So basically he's asking, if I fish, Tad's kind of a shallow power angler, you know, running 80, can he get a full day on a 112 out of a 50 amp 36 volt?
You know, there's a lot of variables to that question. Wind plays a huge factor. Current plays a huge factor. To put it into perspective, the easiest thing way to explain it is, if you have a brand new set of group 31 lead acids, you're looking at about 55-ish amp hours. From the testing we've done, you're looking at about 55 amp hours. So with a single 36 volt 50 amp hour, you'd have a little bit less than what you had with three lead acids. So if you could do it with three lead acids, then I'd say you'd probably be pretty close.
Okay. And then, so the 30, you guys have 36 volts at different sizes. What size 36 volts do you guys have?
We've got a 40 amp hour, which is really popular with the bass guys. All of our Elite Series guys run them. They're all running them in parallel, so they run two of them together for a total of 80 amp hours. Cool thing behind that is now not only do you have 80 amp hours, but you also have a 36 volt backup. So if you're ever out on the water fishing, one of those batteries would go down, God forbid, the other one's going to pick right up where that one left off. You're going to continue on your day fishing unaffected. It's a backup system, and it works real well. So, the other option is the 36 volt 60 amp hour. Now that's real popular with the bass guys. They're running a single with that, just one battery. Like I said, that's going to be roughly 10% more energy than three group 31 lead acids in series. And then obviously you can do two of those in parallel as well for 120 amp hours, and that's more so the deep V guys. We call that the DVX package. That's an in-tune marine term. It's the DVX package. All the DVX 22 guys, they want 236 volt 60 amp hours in parallel, and they love them.
So when you say DVX, you're talking about the big Vexus walleye boat, multi-species boats.
Yeah, the big Vexus. Yeah. Brian and Teal up there at Intune Marine put those 36 volt 60 amp hours, two of them in about every DVX that comes through their shop. So guys have been loving them. So
is that because the walleye guys are just they're just gonna, is that almost like replacing their kicker motor as far as they're just gonna troll so hard with their using their trolling motor versus a kicker motor, and they just
yeah a lot of them are pulling plugs with their trolling motor, which when you have 120 amp hours along with the mm-hmm. running gun system, you can, you know, you can do that. And part of it is just because they want the DVX guys, they want the best of everything, and that's what they get. They'd probably put three of them in there if they could fit them.
Yeah. So, I mean, so going with a single 60 amp would be a little bit, I mean, it would be less expensive than two 40s. Also, you could do it for space reasons, right? You might have a, especially if you, maybe if you have an 18 foot boat or an old, every back compartment's different. And some of the newer ones are getting a lot more spacious, but if you're retrofitting, you may not have room for two 36s. Although
the 40 amp hour is a group 31. So I mean,
size wise, right? So if you have a 31, okay.
Mm-hmm. AGM that you're replacing, right? If you have three of them, then you're going to replace those three with two 40 amp hours. And then what that does is that frees up a spot for your 16 volt electronics battery to go in the position of the third one. And now you're not using any more space, but you have way more power.
And then the 60 amp is a little bigger than the 31 then, or?
Yep, the 60 is a group 5D. So that battery is roughly a half inch longer than a group 31, and then about 3/4 inch wider. So it is a little bit bigger battery, but we do sell the trays for those as well. We manufacture a heavy duty aluminum tray. It's got a rubber pad in the bottom for shock dampening and vibration. Then it's also got a ratchet strap that goes over the top, because everybody knows how to use a ratchet strap, but nobody knows how to use the TH Marine buckle. You agree with that?
I've never had a problem. I don't know.
You can't, you're not a guy that has to watch a YouTube video every time.
Mm-mm.
I'm impressed.
I also don't take my batteries out ever. So, you know,
well, there you go. That could help.
Marty says twice his Garmin 22 sent a message for check voltages, and he said within 15 minutes, basically the battery was dead. So I guess maybe some
Garmin,
electronics.
Garmin. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Garmin will send you a notification on your screen and let you know that your unit's about ready to turn off. You'll start getting connection issues. It'll give you a connection error right before it decides to let go.
All right. So Live in Missouri Outdoors said he bought a 14.8 volt 32 amp hour. Is that the right choice for a 10 inch Livescope system?
I think a 10 inch Livescope draws 2.3 amps on 12 volts. So 2.3 amps and then 3/4 amp. So you're at 2.95 amps. So 32 divided by 2.2.
So he should get about
2.95.
Right?
Yeah.
3 amps.
Yep. About 10 hours. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So, if that's an NMC battery, that's a nickel manganese copper, I believe is what it is. And they have, you know, they're about half the overall life expectancy of a LiFePO4 battery, but a lot more cost effective.
I guess, but like, there's a few questions about 16 volts, but I think we'll jump over there in a second here. But like, so I think we kind of touched on this. Scott wants, I guess, a little more, you know, the benefits of the 236, which we kind of talked about, but I don't. So what we're
going to do in that is we're going to hook positive to positive, negative to negative. So basically you're building one big battery. So you double your amp hourage. So if you have two 40 amp hour batteries, now you have 80 amp hours, which is going to be more than enough for almost anybody. But not only that, if you're ever out on the water and God forbid something happens to one of those batteries, one of them decides to go down, whatever the issue may be, your other 36 volts is going to pick right up where that one left off. You're going to continue on your day fishing unaffected. It's a setup for the serious tournament angler is what it is. And it eliminates downtime on the water.
Yeah. And then like, if, you know, whatever, something freak happens, right, for whatever reason, like we don't expect to have bad batteries, but if for something went wrong, you still,
yeah, nobody, you can, nobody plans that one. Right.
Right. You know, right, and then right. you have a window for the company you're working with for their customer service to do what they do and get you set back up. But that other 40 amp should get you right.
Yep.
Or it just gives you that extra depth of amp hours in case somebody unplugs your boat, somebody trips a breaker at the hotel that, you know, the beautiful suites that RJ's staying at, you know, you would never expect a breaker to trip at a fine establishment like RJ's at tonight.
No, not for here.
$85 a night.
Not here.
But like if it happened, right, you got that extra peace of mind.
Yep. Correct.
Let's talk a little bit. We can bounce back to some of this stuff, but there's been several questions here. Top Toast says, does Powerhouse Lithium make a 16 volt for electronics? I think the short answer is yes. And then Ryan's also asking, what's the advantage to the 16 volts? So let's jump into that. What is all this talk about 16 volts? Cause this is something that's even a little more relatively new, if I'm not wrong, right? Like these are, what, a year or two that 16 volts have been around, or how long have 16 volt?
Yeah, we've,
I guess, batteries designated for grass been in the market.
Yeah, a couple of years. Yep. It's really exploded. The guys that are running them have nothing but positive feedback. Is there any advantage to running? So the biggest advantage to me is it's the best way to combat voltage drop, right? So if you have a 16 volt battery, you have 1 volt of drop throughout your entire wiring system, you're still at 15 volts, you've got an all right picture, everything's fine, nothing's affected, right? You have a 12 volt battery, you have 1 volt drop, you're at 11 volts and your picture looks like straight garbage.
Okay. I guess, I'm trying to do some research on this, learning as fast as I can, because this is definitely something that piques my interest as somebody that's got a Group 31 AGM, got Mega 360, I've got Livescope late in the year, so and that's my only battery, and I'm asking it to do a lot, and obviously, and I think each one of the manufacturers has a little bit different ceiling, right, on the volts that they're head units were on. I need to use some of the different series.
So like all of your Lowrance stuff is going to be 17 volts max. Garmin is 18 volts on the Echo Map series. The GPS Map series is right around, it's 32 point some odd volts. The black boxes for Garmin is 32 volts. The black box, the active target box on Lowrance is 32 volts. And then Humminbird is 20 volts on everything. So we're well within the parameters on everything.
And then what I'm hearing, though, right, is anecdotally, and I guess I haven't been in a boat that's had it, but what I'm hearing is, like, you give them those 16-volt batteries, and they're just like it's almost like a different unit. Like they just run that much better. They're that much crisper. The returns, the signals. Is that true? Yep. Is that really what's happening? Or
yeah. So the biggest thing that we're seeing is like your hard returns come back a lot better. They show up a lot more. They're more apparent. And then the biggest thing I noticed, like on forward facing sonar, is out past 70 foot. It really wakes it up out past 70 foot. I'm seeing my bait out. I'm tracking my bait out further than I did on 12 volt.
Interesting. Yeah, because that's one thing with my, I've got the 34 Livescope Plus. I didn't get to spend a ton of time with it this fall because I didn't get it till September. But I didn't really, like, you hear all these, like, 80, 90, 100 feet. And I was like, I'm not seeing it. Like, right? And so that'll be interesting to see. And that makes me kind of all the more interested in getting in, I mean, into a 16-volt system because that sounds really cool. And then I think the other thing, right, is it gives you, we've got all these harnesses and you can wire it and do all these things to get clean power. But when you're on a separate battery, like that's, and you combine that with the harnesses and wiring, then you really do have.
You have the cleanest power possible at that point, right? Yep.
So you don't have to worry about voltage drop. You're getting clean power. Right. You've done everything within your power to eliminate interference for the most part. The other thing you're doing is you're taking load off your starting battery typically by putting your graphs on their own.
So that's going to last long.
Battery. Then you can just let the whatever it is, whether it's lithium or AGM or whatever your starting battery is, you can let it do the pumps and start the boat and run your lights and do all those things, and a lot less risk dead at the end of the day when you go to run in with 27 pounds in the Livescope.
And that's why our cranking batteries don't last very long, because we put these huge loads on them. Guys running 5-6 graphs, Livescope, Mega 360, all that, put that huge load on them, and they just, that's not what they're built for, and they don't last long. So taking all of your electronics off of that lead acid or AGM cranking and put them on a dedicated 16 volt is, you know, ultimately going to make your cranking battery last longer also in theory. So, one other thing, your 16 volt stuff is it going to run your, equipment about 33% more efficient. So what that means is, let's say your graph draws 2 amps on 12 volt on 16 volt, you're only going to draw around 1.4. So we can do more with less on 16 volt. So basically, a 16 volt 80 amp hour. If I hooked up a 16 volt 80 amp hour on a Garmin 1222, and I hooked up a 12 volt 100 amp hour on that same Garmin 1222, started them both at the same time, they're going to run pretty much neck and neck. They're going to run the same amount of time, and actually that 16 volt will slightly outrun that 12 volt 100 amp hour. The 80 amp hour will outrun the 100 amp hour on the 12 volt. So you get more with less, basically, too.
Interesting. That's how math works, I guess. Steve, our new channel member, says, why does everyone preach harness and higher voltage and then the manufacturers ship units with 6 foot of 18 gauge power cord?
That's so Trent at Sonar Pros can make a living.
Yeah, but I guess I think what he's asking, and I think this a lot of people, right, is like we run all this like a water hose of copper, right, through the whole boat, but then the last 2 to 6 feet is, right? But I think it has to do with distance, right? Like you can get by with a thin strand of copper when you're only using it for 2-3 feet,
right,
or something like that. Is that?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I get what you're saying. Yeah, no, definitely. That's the main thing is you want to have good power, good clean power up to that point. Once you make it to that point, you've got a fire hose feeding a garden hose. So you're not going to be short on power at that point.
But it does seem a little weird. It's like, right? Like, I mean, obviously these screens, we're paying a premium. They're not giving away these 16-inch Apexes and 10-inch Garmins and 12-inch Lowrances or anything, right? It's like, how much would it really cost them to run 14-gauge for 6 feet instead of 18-gauge wire, right? Like, and you'd think it would improve.
Yeah, you know, we've thought about that and talked about it. But the thing is you cut that down past the fuse, and now you don't have a warranty.
Right.
You know, if you want to put a if you want to put a bigger gauge cable on the back of your unit, you can't even do it if you wanted to. Nope, definitely good point. You should email Garmin and let them know.
All right, so back to the 16 volt. Does it require a different charger, or I guess how do you what's a typical setup for you guys? Let's just say, I mean, there's a bunch of different scenarios here, but let's say I'm gonna keep my trolling motor batteries the way they are, whatever I got, and I've got a 31 AGM or what 29 or whatever is in my boat, but I want to add a 16 volt for my electronics.
Yeah.
So I just want to add a stick. That's my only investment into lithium because I want to. How do you recommend, or what is your guys' solution or best solution for installing a 16 volt and getting somebody like that big benefit of the graph part of it with a 16 volt?
Right. So you've got three different options through us. We have an AC wall charger. It's non-waterproof. It comes with an Anderson connector. The one end of the Anderson connector stays on the battery. The other end stays on the charger. You snap it together, plug it in the wall. Downfall of that, it's not waterproof. You have to take it out of your boat. Some guys like doing that. I personally don't. Your next option, we have a 16 volt 10 amp.
So just to recap that one, right? So this is basically a standalone, not installed charger. It's just like the old school, like plug it in. Like,
yep.
It's just like the old plug we used in, to do it.
Clip it together.
15 years, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
You're gonna. Yep. Okay. And that's how much.
Yeah, the bullet I guess, guys how much like that charger. That charger for a 10 amp is $119.99. Yeah. Then your next option, we have a waterproof onboard charger. It's about the size of a single bank, like 10 amp NOCO. It's not very big. It's, you know, it's probably 4 inches by 4 inches and about 2 inches thick. And that's a waterproof charger. You can leave it on board. And it's got a wake up button on it. So if you ever kill your 16 volt battery, that's one thing we didn't go over is how to wake up a battery, but they'll fall asleep if you drain them out all the way. And then we have to run a set of jumper cables or something to a battery that has a charge to wake it up while it's charging. Pretty simple process. Not all that time consuming, but anyways, it's got the button on the charger. So you just hold down on that button and it wakes the battery up. So no more running jumper cables to wake up the battery if you ever do kill it. That charger retails for $140. Go ahead.
I was going to say, so it's a $140. So that just means we're gonna add a second onboard charger dedicated to the 16 volt. So whatever your Minn Kota, your NOCO, your power pole, whatever charger you got now that's running.
It's all
your
on other, its own.
Right. So you're just going to put this in. And the only, I guess, the disadvantage here is you got to plug in two cords at night versus one.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then and that charger retails for $149.99. And then the third option, which is my personal favorite, is the run and gun charger. And that charger is about the size of your TV remote. So it's not very big. It's got two wires that come off each side. You have an input side and an output side. The input side is a positive and a negative. All you do is you hook that up to your cranking battery. The output side, you hook up positive and negative to your 16 volt battery. And then as long as you have 10 amps of input, meaning your charger is a 10 amp per bank, as long as you have 10 amps on that cranking battery, when you plug in that NOCO or that Minn Kota PC at home, it's going to pull that energy from the cranking battery through that 16 volt run and gun, charge your 16 volt run and gun all with that same plug. Now, not only that, but then when you're running down the water, it's going to do the same thing. When you're running down the water, your cranking battery is getting that energy from your alternator. Your run and gun charger sees that. It starts pulling the energy across, converting it to 16 volt and charging your electronics battery while you're running down the lake, which is pretty cool. And we actually offer that system in 12 volt, 16 volt, 24 volt, and 36 volt.
Yeah, that I'm on board with what you're thinking, Nick, right? Like so you're telling me it's an onboard charger, but it's like linked in, right? Like it's in, yeah. I don't know, we'll call it parallel, yeah. Series with, so I got my starting battery, my AGM, whatever it is. And then I basically, Bob, so whether I'm running down the lake, once my main motor is topped off to the point where it's like good, it's going to overflow.
Some mad scientists.
Or at home, yep. Also, I plug in at night. Once my starting battery is recapped for the day, then it's going over and overflowing.
Yep, correct.
That sounds really slick.
Yeah.
And clean. and then obviously you have the right. Then no matter how many graphs you put on that thing, I mean, if you're one of those people that wants to run 4, 5, 6 screens and leave them on 100% brightness and run them hot, as long as you move around a little bit with the main motor, you got almost zero risk of ever like blowing that battery out.
Right. Correct. Yeah. That charger is 15 amps of output. So, you know, if you run 1 hour a day, you're putting 15 amps back into your 16 volt battery. You know, I'd say the average system probably draws 6 to 7 amps. So you run an hour a day, put 15 amps back in, your system draws 6 amps per hour. You've got 2.5 hours of extra runtime on your graphs because you drove your boat for an hour.
And how big is that little unit, or what's the size of that running gun?
It's about the size of a TV remote. Bob's actually going to grab me one out of the truck so I can show you guys.
All right. I suppose I could pull up the website too. That might give some people some visual.
Yeah, the running gun charger is $199.99.
So that's what this guy is here. And so you guys have,
there you go.
What, 48, 60, and 80, and 116. What are most people running for 16 volts? Like, what's the most common, or what's the typical setup for that?
The most common setups, the guys that are wanting the most out of their electronics typically already have a lot of electronics. So the 80 amp hour and the 100 amp hour are probably the most popular. Now, most guys are way oversizing what they actually need, just because, you know, they're spending the money, they want the best. So we're doing a lot of 80s and a lot of 100 amp hours. A few of the 60s sprinkled in there, and then the 48 amp hour is pretty popular on the ice side. And guys with snow bears and stuff like that, they're running their whole unit off of their whole entire snow bear off of one of those 16 volt 48 amp hours, a real small battery.
But I mean, like, where you guys say like 3 devices, 4 to 5, that's assuming no run and gun, right? That's based off just letting it.
Right. That's no run and gun, not figuring in how much you're going to run around throughout a day. And that's pretty generic. That's in place there for people that don't give us a call, because if you give me a call, I can spec out your units, exactly what you have, and tell you exactly what your amp draw is. And I can tell you exactly what you need and how many hours it'll run. Yeah, 1 second. I gotta let Bob in.
Sure. All
right, perfect. That's pretty cool. It. All right, so here's the run and gun charger. It's not very big. So you have your output right here, and you have your input. So this hooks up to your cranking battery. This side hooks up to your cranking battery. This side hooks up to your 16 volt battery, and you've got 4 holes right here for screws. Screw it up to your firewall. Done.
So, like, to me, that seems pretty straightforward. Like, you don't necessarily need to bring it to your marine dealer to install. Like, that's pretty right. So, like, basically, you take your electronic leads off your AGM or whatever you have now, you put them on your new battery, you get a tray for your. Right, and you're basically just hooking that up to there, and that's pretty cool.
Yep, and then we'll also put a circuit breaker on the input side. So not only does that give you another layer of protection, but also when you store it in the winter, your charge light will stay on if it's hooked up directly to your cranking battery. So we just flip that circuit breaker and kill the light for the winter for storage. So
Nice.
Right.
That's yeah, Brian, you are not wrong. It makes me want to order one right now.
He should.
Yeah, I guess there was one question on so I guess on the run and gun, does it matter like how big your motor is, the size of the alternator, or is, have you seen anything where like older motors don't put out enough to fire the run and gun or anything like that, or smaller motors?
Yeah, so on the 12 volt and 16 volt running guns, we're gonna want a minimum of like 20 amps output out of your outboard to fire the running guns. Any less will do it. It just, at that point, it's not really beneficial because it's hard to keep it on when you don't have enough amperage to keep it lit up. But and then on the 24 volt systems and the 36 volt systems, we want a minimum output of 45 amps on the,
so you kind of basically
out of the alternator on your big motor.
Yeah, you got to look at your outboard alternator.
Yeah, so
look at
your specs. So like a lot of all of your two stroke Pro XS's are, I think they're 55 amps. The old E-Techs are 50 or 55 amps. The new Mercury four strokes are 85 amps. The new Yamaha Shows, I think, are 70 or 80. So, I mean, most of your stuff is going to be compatible with that 16 volt. The only thing you got to look out for is if you want to do like the 24 volt or 36 volt running gun.
Devin says he's got a 16 volt 80 amp and he runs three Helix 12s and a 15 with 360 and Mega Live.
How many hours are you getting out of that, Devin?
I don't know if I trust him. He's from Nebraska.
I didn't know Devin even stayed up this late.
Bill Lemieux says, I've got a 16-100 with a running gun, two 12-inch Helix, a 15-inch Helix, a 12-inch Garmin, and he's never been below 70% in a full day of fishing. Cool.
Yeah, with that run and gun charger, you know, especially if you're a guy that runs around a lot. I've had several days on the river. In fact, I fished 13 days without plugging my boat in. Fishing the river, and you know, you're making it's not abnormal to make a 40, 50 mile run. And there were several days where I would make that run and I get back to the ramp after a full tournament day. And I pull open my Powerhouse Lithium app and my 12 volt cranking battery, my 16 volt electronics battery, and my trolling motor battery are all at 100%.
Yeah.
So the cool thing behind that is you get to the hotel after weighing and everybody else is fighting over the three plugins at the hotel. And if you're running the Powerhouse system, you're parked in the back and you've already got the tarp on the boat and cracked open a cold one.
You got the cold one and the smoker fired up and you're just living life.
We just, yeah, yeah. Yep.
Devin says easily 10 hours. So.
Oh, wow.
Bill says that's because you get spun out too easy. I don't know who he's talking to. Yeah, I can imagine like that tournament that I did well in lacrosse where I was running down to like, you know, Stoddard where it was like a 20 mile run every day. Like I would imagine by the time you got back, you'd have a, you know, pretty good charge where you wouldn't have to ask much of your plugging in at night. And if it didn't, you wouldn't, you'd plug them in because you'd want to, but if for some reason it didn't, or there was, you know, a circuit breaker, you wouldn't lose any sleep over it. So, especially when you were going to run 25 miles down there again there in the morning. Right. So,
right. Right. Yep. That's been a big thing with the offshore guys. They're running the 36 volt, 60 amp hour and spot locking for grouper. And they're loving the running gun system. They're never plugging into shore power because they charge on their 2 hour trip out and then 2 hour trip in, and then they're 2 hours back out again. So by the time they get back there again, they're fully charged and they don't ever have to plug in.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. Jim, it'll also work when you plug it in at night. So.
Yeah. So there is a way to do that. There is a way to do that. So option one, what we want, a minimum of 10 amps for the 16 volt and the 12 volt running gun on your cranking battery. So most Minn Kota chargers, NOCO chargers are going to put out 10 amps. So that's not a big deal. The 24 volt and 36 volt running guns, we want 30 amps on the cranking battery. Now, how we do that is when you go from three lead acid or three AGM trolling motor batteries to your 36 volt lithium, now you've got three banks worth of charger leads that you have nothing to do with, right? They're just going to flop around in the back of your boat. So we're able to repurpose those, kind of retrofit your system to charge through your Minn Kota charger. And how we do that is let's say you have a Minn Kota 440 PC, which is probably the most popular charger out there. You've already got 10 amps on your cranking battery, right? You've got three more banks over here. So what we're going to do is we're going to move two of those over. Now you've got three banks on your cranking battery for 30 amps. So now when you plug in that charger, when you plug in your Minn Kota charger at home, that running gun charger is going to see 30 amps coming to your cranking battery. It's going to think that your boat's running down the lake. It's going to turn on and start shuffling power across through the 36 volt running gun and charging your 36 volt trolling motor battery. Now, once that 36 volt trolling motor battery tops off, then your running gun will turn off, and then your cranking battery will finish topping off from 80% up to 100%. The one thing I didn't add is that running gun won't turn on unless your cranking battery is at 80% or above. So we're not going to steal power from the cranking battery unless we can. We're not going to pull it all the way down. It's just to 80% or above, and then it'll shuffle across.
So basically the run and gun. So if you wanted to upgrade to the 36 volt system, the run and gun lets you keep your existing 3-4 bank charger.
Your existing charger, right.
So it keeps you from having to buy new charger dedicated.
Yeah, so we've also got a charger that was designed for the run and gun system, which makes your rigging a lot cleaner. It's a single bank, but it's a 12. So it's a single bank 12 volt 35 amp charger. So all you need is if you've got a brand new boat that you want to rig out with the running gun system, that's the only charger you need. You plug in one plug, you're going to charge your 12 volt, your 16 volt, and your 36 volt all off of one plug.
Right. So if you're ordering a new boat and you really want to do it, you tell them, give me the $400 credit. Don't put that charger in my boat, and then you.
Yeah. And it's going to rig a lot cleaner that way too, because you've only got one bank on your cranking battery, as opposed to three or four. So,
and probably even a little more weight savings in the end.
They're probably at 12 volt, 35 amp chargers. It's about an 8 pound charger. I think the Minn Kota PC is probably, 25 pounds.
At least, probably, yeah.
And they run a lot cooler than the Minn Kota. Yeah, they're cool to the touch. There's no heat on them at all. They've got a big old fan mounted on them. They're nice. Mm-hmm. They don't take up very much room either. They take up a lot less room than a 440 or a 460.
Justin wants to know: does the run and gun cut into the life cycle of the batteries? As far as that whole adage of like discharging further and recharging, does that matter with lithium and? What are your thoughts?
No, it doesn't cut into the life cycle of the battery, and it doesn't even count as a cycle on the charger. It won't count as a cycle on the charger unless you discharge below 80% and then fully charge it back up to 100%.
Cool. Well, look who's finished with basketball.
What's Fish Brian saying?
Yeah, he just said he's done with basketball. Scott wants to know, is there any benefit to the Scott wants to know if there's any benefit to using the power pole charger since they're so expensive with your system.
No. So if you've already got the power pole charge, you can run it with the 16 volt running gun, but outside of that, there's not really a purpose. Now I will say that the power pole charge is, it's constantly moving energy back and forth. And every time you do that, it takes energy to move energy. When you have lithium batteries, there is no point in taking it from this battery, moving it over to this battery, then moving it back to this battery and back to this battery. That's why I like our system. It moves the energy once, and that's where it's at. But like I said, with a lithium battery, there's not really any point to just continue moving energy back and forth between batteries, because, you know, chances are 9 times out of 10, you've already got enough energy. So moving it isn't doing you any good.
Yeah. I was going to say maybe the only thing, right, a power pole charger, because it goes both ways, it might help cover up a bad starting battery for you, or help you limp by with a substandard starting battery, maybe, I guess.
Yeah, that's Brian? One thing we didn't go over. We've got
I was going to say, Brian, we covered the cold weather storage in depth if you go back and watch the beginning of the replay, but so just check that on the replay when you get a moment.
No, we've actually got a cranking battery with an emergency jump start button on it, which is really cool. It's a 105 amp hour cranking battery. Then we've got 7 amp hours of reserve, so it's 112 amp hours total. And it's got a little button on the top. It's got a little button. You kill that battery, all you have to do is reach back there in your battery compartment, hold down on that button for about 3 seconds, and then you have 90 seconds to get back to your console and start your big motor up and get that battery charging again.
So basically,
we got 5 restarts out of one reserve button when we were testing it. So
it's supposed to be
basically a warning is what it is.
A one get out of jail free card, but it sounds like it might give you a couple.
Yeah. Yep, for sure. We got 5 out of it. So,
but in theory, right? Like, the smart thing would be to do is to use the jump, and then drive around for
get
a while.
Get it going.
Your engine, alternator, right.
Yep.
Cool. So I guess one of the things is lithium starting batteries a little bit newer, and I guess there's been a little bit of back and forth with manufacturers. Should you use a lithium? Should you not? What's the story and the latest on, lithium as a starting battery?
So the verdict is still out on Yamaha. We've ran them on a bunch of them, no issues. Then as of about 4 months ago, Mercury came out with a bulletin with a bunch of specifications that they were requiring on their new lithium cranking battery, because Mercury Brunswick bought Relion. So now all of a sudden, lithium cranking batteries are all of a sudden fine. They happen to, all of those specs that they released happen to match Relion's battery that they had released. So we got our hands on this, on these specs, and went to the drawing board. And so our cranking battery actually meets or exceeds every parameter that Mercury requires in a lithium cranking battery now.
Very cool. So sounds like Mercury, no issues running a lithium. Is that what you're saying? But Yamaha works, but it technically doesn't meet their... Could you, if they wanted to be...
No, Yamaha hasn't came out.
Right. So
I haven't even heard of anybody with Yamaha.
Right. But I'm saying technically, if they wanted to be unreasonable, they could probably void your warranty if they wanted to. Technically, maybe, but
they can't void your warranty. They could they could deny the claim on whatever.
Sure. Whatever. Right. Yeah. Deny the claim on the whatever
could,
it is if it,
that they could assess was related to it. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's a better way.
The only thing would be like an alternator or something along those lines. But to be honest, I haven't heard of that happening. I think Mercury and Yamaha are pretty stand up with their warranty program and don't really give anybody a hassle.
But if you're one of those super risk adverse, you know, and you like to have all your T's crossed and all your I's dotted and everything, then maybe wait a few months.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe wait. Yeah, it'll change.
Russell says, what about that buy one, get one special on 36 volt, 100 amps? I don't think that's going to happen. But speaking of that, I guess
Russ is running one of our 16 volts.
The guys at Powerhouse did offer a limited, I think, a three week code of HB10 for 10% off. So if I don't know if you guys found value and you were on the verge of potentially getting a system or getting a battery for your electronics or something like that, this is a discount code for the people viewing this stream tonight. So I really appreciate you guys sharing that with the audience and the community. That's awesome. So, you know, if you guys want to use that, it will be down in the description. Hopefully you can remember HB10. I'll probably delete it out just so it doesn't get like scrubbed by code scrubbers. Obviously, whether you're watching the replay here live or you're listening on the podcast, HB10 for a few weeks here. So basically we'll say, you know, through March, give or take a little bit, basically through the classic, I guess would be a good way to look at it. Right. The classic is 3 weeks from now. So that'd be a good reminder to think of it.
Yep. And, you know, I know there's a lot more questions that probably were not answered. We're available pretty much 7 days a week. If you have questions, you can call us and give us a code and we can process your order that way too. You know, otherwise if you're local in Minnesota, we do have Intune Marine up in Richmond, Minnesota as a dealer. They're our exclusive Minnesota dealer. So I think Rich has a pretty good relationship with those guys too. So
they're not that bad. I mean, they're all right. I mean,
they're all right. Yeah. Jeff's okay. I don't know about that Brian guy and that Teal guy. I mean,
yeah. So I guess speaking of Intune, they are running their open house in 2 weeks. I guess March 18th and 19th.
We'll be there.
2.5 weeks. Oh, you're going to be there. So RJ's going to be there. So if you want to meet the RJ in person, you can go to the the open house. And I'll be there probably a little bit too.
We will be there. So. We'll have a booth. Yeah, you'll be there. So perfect.
Yeah. So, and if you want to meet Fish Brian, you know, that's an option. I don't know why you'd want to do that, but that is an option. But there it is. The open house, March 18th and 19th, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. There'll be, there might be Sobe might be there at some point. I have no idea. But yeah, you can look at batteries, pontoons, electronics, Camus, Vexus, Phoenix, all that good stuff. So, Dan, you're in Minnesota. You can head up to the open house. I'm sure there'll be some kind of special or something going on. You can twist Brian's arm in person. So, that'll be cool. And it'd be good to see some of you
people. I'm going to have to leave my wife at home on that one. I'm gonna have to leave my wife at home. She's been begging me for a pontoon for a year now. So, and they've got a lot.
Well, I mean, Wisconsin, if you're in Western Wisconsin, Intune's not far. But I guess are there any Wisconsin dealers for Intune?
Yeah, we do have Wisconsin dealers. Jacob Kuglich is his name. Let me look it up here. One second. You keep going, I'll find it.
Sure. I have Critical Gravy and a few others. I am actively looking at flights and options to go to the Classic. So I'm definitely leaning that way. I just got to figure out the logistics of it. As long as it doesn't cost me like literally an arm and a leg, I'm kind of planning on it, bopping around the convention. If I do, I definitely will. Once I get it booked, I will definitely post and let everybody know. We'll probably have some kind of meetup somewhere. I'll pick a booth or something and, you know, hang out somewhere where definitely could meet a bunch of people if people are going. Colby says, Vexus, Camus, or Phoenix buying a new boat? I honestly say the Camus has been awesome. There is no wrong answer, that's for sure. I think if you want the Cadillac ride, right, like just, you know, the Vexus has this like presence and size and magnitude. If that's like your thing where you just want like that, then the Vexus is the way to go. I think the Camus and the Phoenix PHX series are really similar as far as like ride and performance. And then the Phoenix XPs are probably a little faster and a little quicker, but also really good. It's kind of personal preference. It really just like, what's your style and what's your, what do you like? But they're all sweet. Yeah. Grand. Did you hear that, RJ? Grand Lake 2024 Classic.
Yeah, I'm pumped. What are your thoughts on the 90 minute one way ride with the fish?
Oh, from Tulsa?
We were discussing in our group chat the other night.
Yeah, I mean they've executed it several times, and it's cold enough that time of year. I don't think it's really an issue, and they've got like, you know, they'll have Gene Gillilander be there, and he'll be heading up a crew, and they'll be taking oxygen levels and adding ice and,
right,
you know, oxygen. I mean, they got everything set up, so it's not really an issue, I don't think. So there's some bonuses. Holy if cow. You are looking at shopping for boats at the Intune Open House, where they're giving away some Omnia gift cards, and you can win an HDS9 just for showing up. And so, yeah, there'll be a lot going on.
Are we eligible?
So if you just want to get out of the house and talk fishing, like the Into an Open House. Yeah, Colby, if you like your Triton, then I would get a Camus. Like, they're like the new and improved version of a Triton, in my opinion. If you want something a little different, Phoenix. If you want to go bigger and, you know, then maybe Vexus. So,
oh, I'm in trouble.
So how are you doing for time? How's your battery hanging in?
Just some boat shuttle. We're getting close. I know. I think, I can't even tell here. I've got 17%.
All right. We'll have to pick
probably
a couple
drawing close to the end. So.
Yeah, a couple key questions here. Let me see. Like, so we might have to do this again. You didn't think we'd be able to talk batteries and boats for an hour, and like it's.
I didn't think we could talk batteries for an hour, man. But right.
But we still got lots of questions. Let's.
I'm trying to find the. We've got a dealer in Neshota, Wisconsin, the Boathouse. I was looking for the Wisconsin dealer question earlier. Mm-hmm. And then we've got,
five
star.
I don't think there's a dealer listing on the website, right? But you can call in or send an email to the website. Somebody will get back to you, right? With your closest.
Yep.
If you,
yeah, and my number's on there as well. I mean,
right.
Go ahead.
Or questions you didn't get answered, or I didn't cover it in enough detail, or we glossed over it. Like, that's what RJ and Bob do. They field questions and get people set up. And like, I mean, that's, I mean, what would you say percentage wise of people that do, like, okay, if they're just buying a battery or something, sure. But like people that get full systems, like what percentage just order versus calling in and like getting it all figured out and set up? Like,
ooh. Yeah. And that's the thing about our system is it's not a one size fits all. It's pretty specialized. So yeah, the rate of people that call in, before they purchase is pretty high. And, you know, typically I'd say the average phone call is 30 to 45 minutes, but we'll walk you through the whole entire process from your cranking battery all the way to your trolling motor batteries and kind of figure out what your needs are and size you out, right? So you don't get something you don't need or miss something that you do need. You get everything in one shot. But yeah, we're pretty much always available to walk you through a system and get you what you need.
But like it's the norm, and it's kind of, I mean, don't feel like you're bothering
them. Oh yeah, if
you're
calling about it's probably questions. 90. yeah. No, and you know, when you're making an investment that large, it's probably a better thing that you give us a call and make sure you get what you need.
We haven't really touched on this. This is kind of interesting. So shallow water anchors, like, do you recommend running off the starting battery, the trolling motor, does it matter? Can you run
your
power off 36 volt system, or do you have to run off the 12? I have no idea. How does that work?
Yeah, you're always going to want to leave those on your cranking battery. We're going to leave all the lights and pumps on your cranking battery. Definitely not on a 16 volt system. I can't imagine how much noise that power poles inject into the system. Probably wouldn't be good for your imaging.
So if you're running 12 volt trolling motor batteries, you could use your shallow water anchors over there, but you're recommended to use them off your cranking.
Yeah.
But if you start getting into any of the,
yeah, no,
the non 12 volt batteries,
yep.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to do that. So yeah.
No, yeah, you can single it out on your first in series and run it off of that. Yeah, definitely. And I've seen a bunch of guys do that. I didn't think about that.
Yeah. But that's another thing, right? The 16-volt system, right? If you separate that, then you can put your anchors on that, and then your anchors are on the same power source as your graphs, and it keeps it clean. That's just a whole nother, right?
Yep. No, definitely. Yep.
There's been a couple of questions about ice fishing portable systems. Like, what do you guys offer or recommend for smaller portable, whether it's ice fishing or John boats or canoes or kayaks? Like, what's your recommendation or go-to batteries for that?
So, you know, there's a lot more to that question that I would need. You know, how long are you out on the ice for? So the most common Livescope setup is going to be a 93 SV, which draws 1.5 amps, and then your GLS 10 black box, which is 3/4 amp. So you're at 2.25 amps to draw on 12 volt. So, you know, multiply, if you want to fish for 10 hours, then you need 22.5 amp hours. On 12 volt, and then obviously 16 volt would be right around 70% of that.
So you guys have some smaller, like
popular one? We've got a 12 volt 6 amp hour, 8 amp hour, and a 12 amp hour. I know Ben Milliken, he was running his Livescope off of the 12 amp hour and had good results ice fishing. So you know, that's an option. You can double them up, you can run two of them in parallel, you can run two of those in parallel and have 24 amp hours. We're also going to bring back, which it kind of went away for a while just because it wasn't as popular, but now we've got all kinds of demand for it. But the 12 volt 30 amp hour, we'll be bringing that back relatively soon. And then past that, you're looking at like the 16 volt 48 amp hour, which that battery is only about 6.5 inches cubed. So it's not very big, pretty portable. It's only about 15 pounds, but it's just a ton of power. I mean, you could probably fish a 3-day weekend from daylight till dark and still have plenty of power left. For as little as that unit is, it's got a ton of power.
So that's the one you're talking about? This one, 1648?
Yep, right. Yep. And that switch is something that we didn't really talk about too. That's kind of cool. That 3-way pergo.
This one?
Yep. Yeah, so that switch. We do a lot of those on our 16 volt systems. What I do is I rig my 16 volt on the number one post on the back, and I hook up my 12 volt cranking battery to the number two post, and it's a backup system is what it is. So if you're ever out on the water and that 16 volt battery dies, all you have to do is reach back in your battery compartment, flip that switch from number one over to number two, and now all of your graphs and transducers that were hooked to your 16 volt are now running off of your 12 volt cranking battery, which is a real cool backup. It's something we do with about every system. We've got some kind of way to have a backup.
Nice. Yeah, that is pretty cool. So like, right. I mean, yeah, you'd have to go back to archaic 12 volts for your graphs for the afternoon, but at least you'd be fishing with.
Yeah. Yeah. You got that right.
That's cool. Yeah, a lot of great information. So if you guys came in late, I definitely think it's worth going back and re-listening to this for sure. Sean, late to the party, but yeah, I think this one, if you're interested in boat batteries and amp hours and all that stuff, I think lots of good stuff to go back and catch if you came in late. Did you mention All Out Marine in Wisconsin?
Yeah, All Out Marine, Jack Kuglich. Yep, he's a dealer.
A couple guys asked about the nation qualifiers. We'll probably talk. You know what, RG, I'll probably go in a little bit, and maybe we'll dive into some of that stuff.
Yeah, Bob's gonna die of starvation here pretty quick. So,
I appreciate your time, RJ. Awesome. It was good catching up. I learned a lot. I'm especially intrigued by the 16 volt system. I might have to be using that HB 10 code myself, to get a 16 volt battery for the Caymus.
For sure.
To get a little more heat out of the 360 in the Livescope. So
yeah.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
We'll probably hang on here and talk for a little bit more with the people hanging out. I'll try not to answer any battery questions I'm not qualified for, but, appreciate your time.
Yeah.
See you at the open house in a couple weeks.
Yeah, you know, I'll be there. We will see you then.
All right, well, go enjoy yourself and safe travels.
Will do. Stay safe. We'll see you. Bye.
All right. Well, that was pretty cool. Yeah, lots of good information here. Joe says he's be using the code tonight for the 16 volt. Awesome, Joe. Yeah. There were so many more questions. I got a bunch more start here, but like literally Yeah, I think he said at the beginning he only had his truck charger for his phone. It was in the truck, and so he had no way to plug in his phone. So Troy and a few other people, Trenton, you guys had some. I think if your Livescope is telling you you're only getting 10.10 volts, that you either have a battery issue or you have a wiring issue. But that is my uneducated answer. Like, you should be much closer to 12 if you've got a good battery and your wiring is set up, 12 plus. I know when I plug my Garmin in, I'm starting out at, you know, close to 13 at the beginning of the day. So you're probably not getting the performance you need. And it could be a wire gauge. It could be the wiring setup. It could be the battery. They're just, you know, that'd be something you'd have to really just kind of troubleshoot. But that doesn't seem like a great solution based on my limited knowledge, Trenton. Try saw your question. That would have been a good one to get in. Um, if you're using a lithium as a starting and cranking battery, as you go dead, can you jump it off a portable pack? I believe so. You can also, I think, jump off your trolling motor batteries, but as long as they're 12-volt trolling motor batteries. If you have 24 or 36-amp trolling motor batteries, you cannot jump them. You definitely want to carry a jump pack in that case. But like I think he also mentioned their lithium batteries have a built-in jumper. So that's also good. Clay, downfalls of lithiums. We kind of covered that in a little bit more in depth. RJ gave his kind of spiel at the beginning. But yeah, I mean, if upfront price, he even gave some examples where the upfront price, if you compare it to like some of the, I forget what the company, like the X2 lithiums. I mean, some of those are, I don't know, $300-$400 a piece. And I think he said you could get a 36 volt lithium for $900. So sometimes they're really not that far off. But he covered a bunch of that early on. I'm not going to speak for him. Dan, you know, these like runtime volt questions, that's a great question to call and get the calculations. Yeah. So this related to your other question, Trenton. If you're running a 24 AGM with 5 graphs, that's probably part of your problem with your 10.10 volts. I definitely would consider bumping up to a 31 AGM at minimum. Darius definitely has been very happy with his lithiums. I've got some 12-volt lithiums for my trolling motor, and I definitely think we didn't really talk a lot about trolling motors, but I feel like they are pretty legit. Like, I feel like you definitely get more snort and more energy. Like, your trolling motors run better and hotter on lithium, anecdotally. Brian says X2s are $460 a piece. Yeah, Daniel says undersized wiring. That's why I kind of custom, I think I used 10 gauge. I either ran 12 gauge to my Livescope and 10 to my box, or 10. It was either 12 and 10 or 10 and 8. Yeah, well, I guess he needs a... You know, the thing is, if you don't bring the cord for your iPhone and you only have the one in the truck, it doesn't do you much good. Yeah, I definitely, that run and gun sounds like a great way to me. Like, my opinion of, like, if I'm going to invest in lithium, I actually have trolling motor batteries, and I do think that's good, but if I was only going to invest in one portion of lithium, it would be to get a 12 or a 16-volt dedicated electronics battery. I think if you were going to invest in lithium and you're a person that uses your graphs and your electronics, I think that is where you're going to get your biggest bang in your buck. Then secondly, trolling motor also, I think, is a pretty good investment if you fish a lot and you're on the trolling motor lot and you're tournament fishing and you're fishing 10, 12 hour days and back-to-back days. I think that would be my second most important. And I think, to me, the cranking battery is kind of a distant third as far as like how I would invest in lithium. But that's just my opinion. Oh, interesting, Clay. Well, maybe you can come on sometime and lead the stream. That is one thing I have heard different things, is that sometimes the weight reduction, depending on the boat, they don't necessarily, it changes the way boats run, sometimes positive, sometimes negatively. What's up, Gabe? Steve says he has a 30 amp and his back gives out long before the battery when ice fishing. Yeah, I guess I missed this one, John. So I guess I would just send an email or call him and they would probably tell you. I know they just set up a bunch of new, he was telling me they were traveling through Alabama, setting up dealers there. So I would just call the shop or send him an email. Qualifiers. A couple people talked about the Bass Nation. I've known about this for a little while. So I think a lot more people are going to get the opportunity to go to the qualifiers, which replace the regionals. little bit higher entry fee, which I think is can be somewhat good, because if you do well in these tournaments, I think you can actually like get some money back and actually make some money and be somewhat profitable, as profitable as you can be in tournament fishing, which in general is not a great profitable way to spend your money. So I think like if you get a top 10 or a top 20 at a qualifier, I think you're actually going to do pretty well financially with a 250 belt tournament on a $400 entry fee. So I think that's good. We're going to get, you know, more people are going to get a chance to fish a nationals, which gets more people a chance. It's definitely going to take, I know they said they're still going to make it a big event. It's going to be a spectacle, but it's, I don't think it's ever going to be quite the same as the three that I fished, which were like 50, 55 boat nationals, which were like mini classics as far as how they were run with boatyards and putting you up in hotels and busing you back and forth. It's definitely going to be much more of a Bassmaster Open. Like the qualifiers will be like your regular Bassmaster Opens. And I think the championship will be like the old Bassmaster Open Championship. Not saying that's not a big event, but I think it'll definitely be a little different. I've heard rumors. They have not published this, but I've heard that they're hoping that the national champion will cash prize might be closer to $100,000. Whereas I think Maddie Wong and Will Davis Jr. probably run around 20 when they won. So that'll be a big deal for the person that wins. I mean, then if you win the national championship, you'll be in a much better position to move on to the elites with that living the dream boat package, your entry fee credits, and then you win whether it's $50,000 or $100,000 more, then you're going to be in a much better position to move on to the elites. Yeah. You know, they're still only going to send three. So it's going to be three to the classic out of 250 instead of 50. So more people getting a seat at the table, but your chances of making it once you make the nationals definitely are not as high. I mean, really, right? You got to think about this. They're basically taking the Bass Nation and they're taking the single division opens where they took that away, right? The people that are like the working man, I don't no longer can fish three opens and make it to the class or make it to the elites. And they basically are just taking those together and kind of smashing it up into a new Bass Nation program to appease both sides. I think there's some good. I think there's some downside. But overall, I guess we're all still, for the most part, fishing for each other's money. And we got to try some new things. We got to make some changes. And, you know, if we just stay stagnant, I'm open, trying to be open-minded, and I'll definitely be participating. I think that's right. If you're only getting 10 volts out of 12 volt battery, the battery's dead. So that would tell me that there is some kind of loss in his system. Gopher Haze. I grew up in Kentucky, learned on the land between the lakes. Moved to Wisconsin, where fishing is easy, like Minnesota. I don't know why you became a walleye nut, but okay. You may be over by Bago. I guess the biggest thing you'll see here is that, like, we get a lot of bites in tournament fishing here. So, like, and depending on you might have been around in Kentucky back when it was really good, but fishing is pretty good up here. You got to learn to fish grass. Other than that, I mean, bass fishing hasn't changed that much. You know, join a local club. That's probably the biggest thing. You know, you find buddies in your area, you learn the lakes, you learn tips, you learn kind of the local what works in this region. That would be my recommendation, is just join a Bass Nation club. Ooh, that's a good point. We'll probably look at that. I'm thinking maybe a members only stream Friday night. What do you guys think? Maybe a little after hours HellaBass, open some tackle. I was thinking about maybe rewatching like an old Bassmaster Elite series and do kind of like a mystery theater type reaction to it. I think my understanding is Minnesota is getting 6 direct qualifiers to the Natty based on our membership. And then the next, whatever, 10 or 20 slots will go to the qualifiers. Hopefully they think about through some of these things, JJ. And hopefully the people that are in established clubs and people that fish state tournaments will get priority. Like, there'll be like waves. And so that the nation guys, like the established nation guys will get at least a window to fill up these qualifiers before people that just have like just a Bear Nation member. But I guess we'll see. Ed Cowan won 15,000 in 1991 and 2005. Yeah. So, and I think when I took second at the regional, Northern Regional, the guy that won 5K and I got 3K for second. And, you know, so I think that prize pool should go up considerably for both the qualifiers and the nationals. A couple people saying they're down for Fridays. Nope. Well, I think I'll probably open the Omnia box on Friday or a feature stream. Gotta have some mystery. Anything else going on? Other questions? I gotta start this weekend. I'll be looking into more details for the classic. So if there's anybody's going for sure, or they got an open spot or an open bed, or they're headed that way, and I'd be happy to keep costs down if there's anybody interested. But otherwise, yeah, I'll be at the Intune open house a couple weeks. Yeah, I'll try to get that probably scheduled tomorrow so that it'll send out a notification at least a day in advance for the members only stream. I heard Jordan Lee and Pangrack talking about that evening stream BTL, and they were like reminiscing over those old elites, and I watched them on YouTube and I was like, you know, it'd be fun. Like, get a bunch of us in a little watch party, members only. We'll watch and comment and react to kind of some old elite series, because there was some pretty cool stuff. There was a vibe back then that it was different, and I think it'd be kind of fun to hang out and chat about that. Maybe I could convince somebody to come on and react to the streams. Or maybe one of you would like to come on the video. AJ, would you want to come on and talk about old school Bass Elite? The big furry spoon. You know, I kind of trimmed it, Sean. It's probably not as bad, you remember? Like, back in Christmas, this thing was like... Nick, you'd come on and talk? All right, maybe I'll hit me up in my DMs on Instagram, anybody that wants to come on Friday night and kind of have a conversation about a... We could check with TK. You know, he's got his own Patreon stream, so I don't know if he wants to hang out in my member stream now, so... yeah, that's definitely one. I watched the first ever Ishman Rowe first level elite series last night when I went to bed. That was pretty fun. So we're talking about rooming together, spoon sliding into my DMs. This has really derailed at the end of the stream. All right, well, lots of people said they'd be in. So, Sean, where have you been? You're not part, what do we call it? We're the tackle campers with a K. Man, Sean, you missed out. You missed out on the Marty Burns where he hand carved a balsa in front of all our faces 2 weeks ago. Come on, Sean. What are you doing with your life? Yeah, he actually has one tomorrow night, 7:30 p.m. There's a TK Patreon stream. It's a big Bagley show. So I'll be hanging out tomorrow night most likely with in the TK and in the comments. His first stream was pretty good, his first Patreon. So, did you get the results of your bar yet? Are you still like waiting in anticipation? Yeah, Ed, I want to have you on one of these days. I'll have to send you a DM because I think you've got some great stories about the old school Bass Nation that I would love to hear. I've definitely seen you on Ike's show and a few other places, and I think you got a lot of perspective that would be cool to get that from back in the day. Short stream tonight. Maybe I'll go visit with my family. That'd be weird. Yeah, Sean, when do you hear on the results? Everybody wants to know. Otherwise, next week's going to be a little iffy. Because I might have to travel for work. So I will do a stream next week. I just don't know when it's going to be. It depends on when that work travel happens. It might be a Thursday or Friday stream instead of a Wednesday stream next week. But then in 2 weeks on the, was it the 15th, maybe Wednesday? I'm having Shane Durant, who's one of the Bassmaster Elite Series photographers. He's going to come on and give us some like behind the scenes nuggets and stories from being a photographer for Bassmaster Elite tournaments. So I think that'll be pretty cool. Did they send an email about their terminal sale? So you won't know till April, Sean. What's up, Everett? No drawing tonight, so you won't win tonight. I'm sorry. When do you think you're going to get a question mark? Oh, nice. Yeah, that would be some great stories, Ed. When do I think I'm going to get on the water? That's a good question. I mean, I would think if I go to the Classic, when I come back, we'll be pretty close to getting on the river up here, I would imagine. Yeah, I grabbed a reel and some baits to take advantage of that 2x premium points sale that ended on the 27th. So I'll show those off a different... the premium is the deal. Yeah, they're running. They're in the middle. They're on week two of their 4 week spring spectacular. So lots of good stuff from Omnia. I guess they're trying to get ahead of the Classic stuff because typically the other people. So Omnia's MO seems to be like they like to run their big sales right before, right? So like, most of November, they run their big sales, and then they don't do much. They just do a few doorbusters at Black Friday. And then now it seems like they're ramping up in the beginning of March, doing a bunch of big sales and premium point stuff, and then they probably won't do a lot at the Classic, and then they'll let the other people. So I think, yeah. The Omnia, the membership is a good deal. And a boy, JJ. It's good for the soul, just what the doctor prescribed. I have not caught a bass since November 12th, but I did catch a snook, a little baby snook in mid-January. Does that count? They're kind of like a saltwater bass. Just a cute little guy, about like that. That is true. I have heard that. Like, I don't think they outly, but typically Omnia will match other people's sales within reason, unless it's like a clearance type situation. True, AJ. True. And there's a new code. I guess I didn't forgot to update that. If you guys haven't cracked the algorithm on how the code charge changes every month for my code, I'll throw it up on the bottom of the screen. There officially is a new code. So if you use the February code and you were waiting for the March code so you could use it and get an order in, there's the new code, OMHB23MAR. And then obviously the Arsenal code's still good. Dan is supposed to be having a bunch of good stuff, like some new swim jigs and some new apparel and some new tools and a bunch of stuff coming, landing soon at Arsenal. So snook or smallies on crack. I think I saw your little IG post with your cute little bass, AJ. I need to go to St. Clair. That's on my list. Yeah, they need to get back. There's some stuff that needs to get back in stock. I don't know if they're waiting on dealers or if they haven't ordered it. So JJ says snook are smallies on crack. Critical Gravy says snook is a saltwater pike. Those are two very different opinions. Size matters on the Big Bass podcast. That's what they say on Ken Duke and Mr. Batista. Size matters on the Big Bass podcast. I only have the Omnia membership. Have not found a need for the American Legacy. Well, don't tempt me with a good time. I just need to find the time. I'm actually thinking about, I was looking at my tournament schedule today, and I'm actually thinking about going less aggressive. I'm still going to fish a bunch of tournaments, but I'm going to fish a bunch of tournaments, I think, where I won't have to take a bunch of time off from work, where I'll just like bop off Friday afternoon, pre-fish Saturday, fish a one-day Sunday tournament, and save my vacation time and maybe do more cool stuff, like go visit Steve or somebody else and go fish Lake St. Clair, or go down and meet AJ at Okoboji, or meet TK and AJ and go out to Big Stone and do more of that stuff. So I think that might be maybe the MO. Do more more meet trips where I get to do some, like, go meet some really cool people and film some really good fishing, not in a tournament situation, and still fish tournaments, but maybe focus more of my PTO on doing some cool stuff, or maybe taking days off work when it's really nice and just go fishing locally and crack on them and not fight the crowds on the weekends. So we'll see. That might be the thing. I'm kind of talking myself into not fishing the BFLs and fishing the TBF team trail and a couple state tournaments and, you know, having more fun doing more cool stuff. So that might be the plan. Maybe go down and visit the Doc Patton and the friends down and go fish the river and hang out. Maybe something like that. See, I don't even know what the pits are, but that sounds awesome, Nick. Thoughts on going back to Grant? Geographically, it would be an easier, shorter drive for me to go there than Knoxville. It just seems like it's one of the things. I mean, there's just like, with the time frame they're having the Classic, and there's only a certain amount of lakes that can hold it that are near metropolitan areas that are going to cough up the cash that have the infrastructure. So we're kind of stuck in a rut where there's probably only, what, 6 or 8 places they can reasonably have a Classic. Yeah, go down with JJ and Dustin. So I guess I'm not surprised, right? It's like, it's Grand, it's Hartwell, it's Gunnersville, Knoxville. Like, I don't know. There's probably only 6 or 8 places reasonably to have it. You know, I don't think the Delta, I think the Delta fishery is not what it used to be. Maybe throw some swim baits, Nick. The big bait. Yeah. So if you guys got ideas for cool filming up things, that's part of the thing, is I do want to be able to film these and bring these to everybody. So if we can do it in a way that doesn't expose your spot and makes it a cool story to tell on video. That's the one, you know, thing about the Classic is, like, the Spring Classic is cool. The Summer Classics are tough, but I think a rotating Classic or an alternating Classic would be really cool, because, you know, wouldn't it be cool to have a Thousand Island Classic or a Champlain Classic? I mean, I don't know if those cities have the infrastructure to hold it. I mean, but it would be really nice to be able to see a little more variety and have some more, you know, lacrosse or something as a Classic, or I don't know. But I don't know if that's probably a pipe dream. Oh my gosh, Nick. Trout, vitamin T. Interesting. But would Philly send the money to Bass to lure them? That would be the question. Chicago ruins it for everybody, Sean. You should know that by now. What else is going on? Thanks to Arsenal for supporting the stream and the channel as usual. But you know what? my wife and kids are flying out in the morning, so I'm probably going to go visit with them and call this a stream at just under 2 hours. Appreciate everybody that came in. If you came in late, this one's definitely worth a listen. Yeah, we need to convince TK to come up to Pigstone. That'll be good. Yeah, thanks for coming in. This stream is definitely worth it. I think I say that most of the time, but I really feel like the technical expertise shared by RJ, there was a lot to learn there. So I think listening to it on the podcast, the Facebook replay, the YouTube replay, well worth a listen. If you need a lithium battery, use that code. It's out there. You know, 10% is 10% on a lithium battery. So probably see most of you guys Friday night. As always, here to help you guys catch more big bass and suck less. Thanks, everybody.